thank you for those speakers, including our own Ken. Still have questions and answers.
So how was the speech, everybody? Was it good? For the next part, it's pretty much almost the end of the program, but this is actually the most exciting part and interesting part, is the Q&A. Tony would like to present. Okay, let's do the certificate of appreciation. President Tony Lee would like to present a certificate of appreciation for Mr. Tenzing Chongdun. Thank you for coming here and sharing with us.
On behalf of FAPA, and I'm sure all the Taiwanese Americans, we thank you for all that you've done in pursuit of human rights and determination for not just your people, but inspiration for all of us. Thank you.
那个同意是 group 吗？
Okay, while you're taking pictures, I'll just briefly explain the Q&A session. So first of all, we have a few prepared questions collected from our organizations that we can ask them to kind of answer those questions. And if after they have completed those 5 questions, we will be open to anybody in the audience who has some questions for them as well. So, okay. The first questions that we have is from Kwakwa, is that what are some of the obstacles and challenges you faced when you're trying to make your situation, your country's situation, your nation's situation understood and addressed by the international community? Mr. Mia
to have activities, and it's been a challenge for us.
So the question was about challenges.
Yeah, we're trying to make your situation
known. And since being the Tibetan experience, our biggest challenges has been there's no access for media inside Tibet. You know, whereas in Hong Kong, at least you were able to get press there, but inside Tibet, we have never been able to have any press be able to show what was actually happening. So sometimes it was very tragic. You would have someone self-immolated a month ago, we find out a month later. And by that time, really, you know, for a lot of people here, media, they would like, you know, the most current, immediate, and then of course people to be able to show and you know, their stories to be heard. But in our Tibetan situation, most of the time it is takes many, many months, and we don't have footage to show. But unfortunately, even people that have suffered, very few are able to come out and speak, and that is one of the biggest challenges. And then, like Ms. Goodyear said, for us in the international community, there are many countries that have very strong relationships with the PRC, economic interests, and other security concerns, interests. You know, those are all very important for everyone. At the same time, then when it comes to human rights and self-determination of the Tibetan people, certainly that gets pushed aside. So we may get some symbolic support, you know, and that's it, you know. So to have real meaningful support where it would actually convince some of the leadership to say, oh, this is time to make some changes to the policies so that there's the Tibetan people's aspirations, or at least their frustrations over these repressive policies are addressed. But that doesn't happen so because of, again, Tibet being so remote and so far away. And we do have a lot of minerals, et cetera, like, you know, and all of that is being used at the same time. Unfortunately, the deterioration many people themselves have nothing to show for it. You know, and we have had, as even in the Uyghur friends, Tibetan, the language has been marginalized. So most Tibetans, in order to get some jobs, have to learn Mandarin. And then, but a lot of the schools, so Tibetan people, Tibetan language dying. And when they come to exile and go to Tibetan schools, thanks to the aid from many other countries, we're able to at least preserve our language and culture.
Xitay hükümeti iqtisadi cəhətdən bütün dünyaya pul veriş arqılı Rabia Qadrını, məclislər olunuz, Dalai Lama'nı deyiniz, başqalarımızı olsun. Kırgız mənlərdə dövlətlərə bizim kirişimizin altını aldı və şu dövlətlərə bizim qubul kirişimizi çəkləyir. Başta anlaydıqan dövlətlər var.
And through the economic prowess of the Chinese government, they started to let's say, kind of buy a lot of interested organizations in various countries to tell them that please do not let Rabia Qadri enter the country and have any activities and things like that. So they use their economic prowess and ever increasing geopolitical power to stop our activities.
So Hong Kong is a very unfortunate place because a lot of international media are based in Hong Kong. So a lot of the events you see on New York Times or Washington Post all the time. My wife is Taiwanese and she complains that, oh, Hong Kong again. But we understand that we have to really fully use this situation and really, whenever China does something that's violating international law or like rules, that we expose them and we raise a lot of noise about kind of everything. And so that's how we kind of let our thing know and really kind of expose the human rights violations of China. And hopefully through Hong Kong, we can help the other things.
就是想要piggyback on what Lina was saying a little bit earlier. I think Hong Kong it is very lucky that we are a more international community, and then we have a bit of a voice internationally. But at the same time, we're still trying to get more international publicity and understandings and sympathy for our cause. Right now, we are trying to make Hong Kong pro-democracy are working with the U.S. government and different teams to try to understand the Hong Kong histories and some of the rights that we actually had, what we should have had during the times that we were under the British and currently under China. Right now, even though that we are under the one country, two systems, there are certain rights that we should have. Previously, when we are with Great Britain, there are certain rights that we should have as colony as well. So right now we are doing a lot of history gathering, a lot of fact-finding on all the things that we should have rights to before and currently so that we can better in the future doing self-determination as to what is Hong Kong's future, whether it is getting autonomy, whether it is getting the governor of democracy, what type of path is it going to be. So right now we're continuing to fight like that.
Just to speak a little bit about Taiwan, from my past experience, 228 incidents and also the previous white terror martial law, Taiwan has been pretty alone in the world. And I think the biggest challenge for Taiwanese people is that we are living in a place where it's not recognized by the International Committee as a country, as a sovereign state. So when it comes to the situation with Taiwan, the rest of the world pretty much just kind of ignores us. And I grew up here in the United States. When I was talking about 228 to my classmates, or maybe during history class, I would raise my hand and bring up about the past atrocity happening in Taiwan. Maybe it's an innocent response from the rest of classmates, but they would say, hey, you know, you guys only lost about 30,000 people. And compared to the rest of the world, where the Holocaust lost 6 million, Armenia lost 2 million, or like, Nanjing massacre lost 375,000 people. You guys are not really that significant. And it hurts that time, but I realize as I get older, like, that's kind of like the reality Taiwan's facing today, is that people don't really give Taiwan the kind of recognition that a lot of other nations might have. For example, Hong Kong is a financial center in Asia, so they have always been on, have a lot of publicity. Everybody knows what Hong Kong is. And when it comes to Tibet, you know, there's a lot of Hollywood celebrities that endorses their cause. And Uyghurs, I know personally that a lot of Muslim countries, they kind of view them as part of the brethren. So Taiwan is really, compared to them, it's a very alone, it's very tiny. So I think that's one of the biggest challenges Taiwan has when it comes to trying to bring our situation out to the world. So for our next question, just for the guests here, is what are your plans to respond to future government genocides or maybe repression? Because right now we were all kind of representing different nations and we all have different situations and we're facing different kind of obstacles. So based on your experience and your knowledge on the issue, how do you plan to respond to future government repressions?
We, in every nation faced with this atrocity, there are those who fights with violence and power, there are those who fights with the peace, but either way, what does not change is the fact, the atrocity that those countries have committed against humanity, and it is something of a worthy cause to stand up in such that it should be the universal of each human soul to stand up against justice wherever it is.
Bu meselede en katı durduğun nesne, Tibet meselesi, Uygur meselesi, Tayvan meselesi, Meli Çangal meselesi, Jungo'nun işki meselesi diyenini dünya taşlaştırarak biz Amerika'nın bunun kalit kılışımız gerek.
In a more strategic front, the fact that the lies that the Chinese government has been spreading around the world, stating that Tibet, Taiwan, and East Turkestan is Chinese internal problem, that lie has to be exposed such that it is not Chinese internal problem. It is an independent problem that not only the Chinese government, but the world faces. And we have to bring that out in the front. So now the important thing is we have to unite Taiwan, Shanghai, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and Tibetan, and all of the sufferings, the minorities who suffer under the Chinese government. We have to unite to fight with a uniform voice, starting with the United States and the United Nations, that we need to stand up and say it is not an internal problem of Chinese government. It is a problem that humanity faces and has to be addressed and has to be faced to really solve the problem. We have to be able to talk about it, expose it, and let people know in an informative way. And bringing it to the attention of the United States and the United Nations is a really strategic step.
Biz muşul olmayı hal kılmayı durup, muşul, şiki işi diyenini hal kılmayı durup, mesela hal kılamayız. Bu dünya, bu Amerika, bütün dünya muşul, bizim muşul, besinimizin ortak kıp, muşulunu kayıl kılışımız gerek. Bu dünya tınışlık olduğu için, hiç kaçar bu mesele cümlenin kişi meselesi olmayı. Muşulunu biz dünyanın kayıl kılışımız gerek. Bu Amerika'nın, Amerika'nın, Amerika'nın.
So the so all of us brothers from Taiwan, Hong Kong, Tibet, and all of the people suffering within China proper, we have to unite to expose the unprecedented ignorance and lies of the government that try to cover up the fact that it is not a problem that is just internally can be solved and can faced by Chinese government because it is the math does not add up there because you cannot solve a problem unless you don't believe it is a problem. And what we need to do is, we have to bring the attention of the United States and the United Nations that it is a problem. It is indeed a problem of the Chinese government, but at the same time, it is a huge problem for world peace. And then, we are able to form an arena where we can say and sit with the Chinese and talk about and find a solution in the future.
Yes, definitely, this is something that should concern all of us. I was just thinking that whenever there's a natural disaster, whether it's an earthquake or some famine, obviously countries everywhere help each other. We have, but just like that, when you have people being repressed systematically by government, regardless of what the grievances are, then that ought to be looked at as another disaster that the world needs to care about. And ultimately, especially what I've learned here, being here in the U.S. You know, certainly we are isolated, we are very fortunate with all of the privileges, the rights that we have here, of our judicial system that, you know, while you work, whether you are wrong, there's an injury at work, or there's someone, there's something where there's an injustice, you're able to take that up and fight for justice, or at least, you know, in China right now, we won't have the judicial system that is transparent. So anytime any people have any kind of grievances, there is no fair way of due process given to those people. So what the other important thing is that if we do not condemn these injustices, whether it's in Africa or in East Pakistan or in Tibet or in Taiwan or Hong Kong, someday it will happen here too. Because big business interests and all of the other things that you hear about, you know, the being able to, internet, emails, everything that can be actually data mined, they can literally want every kind of communication that you have. So if you have any kind of a criticism of government, of policies, you could be subject to laws, their severe punishment, reprisals. So those are things that we have to see here, say that it's not just, even in Taiwan right now, certainly there's people there that enjoy a lot of freedom, but someday it may be taken away. Same thing in Hong Kong, and same thing even here. So we have big businesses that are actually sometimes colluding with regimes that do not care about basic human rights and freedoms. So guess what happens? Those big businesses will give out all that information and pretty soon, you and your family could be subject to, you know, very unpleasant, treatment. I mean, everything from your work to your social life to, and the other things that could be done. You know, in the name of terrorism, you could be, or say security, those things are, you know, given so that someone can get imprisoned and then for many years. So it is very important that we stand up for everyone every time we see some atrocity, injustice happen anywhere, we have to stand up together And then, ultimately, as Dalai Lama has, and we have seen some examples, sometimes nonviolence doesn't get the most, response, because they only respond to violence. But even though it may be long, but the public and everyone with their vigilance, if you bring up that information and expose whatever injustices are or atrocities, hope, and through press and through civic vigilance, hopefully the governments that are involved will be transparent and will have to account for them. And we can hopefully avoid such atrocities.
So Hong Kong is still just the beginning stage. A lot of other places have already experienced, but then I kind of just echo what everyone else have already said. I think what from Hong Kong's perspective, we need to educate everybody as to what Hong Kong has been through, what Hong Kong is, and what China is doing. A lot of what Chinese government has been saying is lies. What they're saying about South China Sea, about how we should be dealing with Taiwan and Hong Kong, that it is an internal matter, internal situation. It is not. From Hong Kong perspective, from the Sino-British Joint Declaration, there is a big role that the British still plays right now, even though Hong Kong has handed back to China. British is responsible for what's going on in Hong Kong. Besides the British, there are other countries, including the U.S., have responsibility in the contract, in the relationship. They were there for the signing of the declaration. All the rights that has been taken away in Hong Kong right now, U.S. has a role to play with that. British has definitely a role to play with that. But they have turned their backs against us. So, just echoing what everyone else has been saying, we got to fight together, we got to help each other in our fight for democracy.
Yanıbırtanımdan biz bu yalnız ben ayrı çıkıp Uyghur ayrı Tibet ayrı Şangham ayrı kısa işimiz tersi burada dedi.
I have this call to make here today. The point I'm trying to make across is if you stand alone and shout and no matter how hard we try, we're not gonna make any uniform front. And then let the world know that the dire nature of the problem.
Biz bir geldi tutsak buldu, menimçe biz birleşip, her yerde bir ortak bir davatlılığın bir nesini meydan çıkartırsak.
I strongly recommend today that we should consider forming a unified umbrella front where all of the especially people related to China, and even beyond, to get together and just have a platform to talk about those injustices, regardless of where it happens. And I recommend that all, and I ask all of you to consider forming a unified front. Thank you.
Due to a restraint of time, I'm gonna move to because I think most of the guests has covered much more, and there are some questions that are being covered, so I'm not going to go with that. I have one last question from the prepared question list, and I do have a couple written questions from the audience, which I will read them afterwards, after we finish this question. If there's something that you wish children of the world 100 years from now on can learn from this past, and not repeat the tragic histories, what would you want them to learn from the events that just happened this century?
I'll say is understanding our differences and accepting them instead of trying to make everyone the same, like China. All they do is try to make everyone Chinese. And we need to really learn to accept there are different culture groups, different people, different opinions, and we need to learn to accept them instead of trying to change them.
Başka Allah'a, başka nispeten üç benlik, bir temsizlik olur.
I really genuinely hope though to let those children know and to have them to make such a, like from the deep down, no hatred whatsoever. Instead of not hating the differences, I'd like to have them a heart where they celebrate differences and love differences, and that's the only way to make peace. And I would like to have them to feel equal with each other, no matter how their differences is.
Yeah, with other distinguished guests, I have a similar thought in terms of, you know, certainly when you, example of the European Union, when countries tried to went through World War that were enemies at one time, and then later thought, okay, it is better to, for both, you know, the nation's security and prosperity and peace, it is good to have a union where you respect each other's differences, countries' traditions, at the same time, come up with rule of law, democracy, press, transparency, all of those are important. But when you're forced to join, then what happens is certainly there's resentment. And then if that resentment goes unresolved for many years, certainly it becomes bad tragedy for the people all involved. So certainly I think that is one thing that a lesson for all of us, that you know, that people who go to China would see that you have nationalities that would definitely all benefit from working together, living in harmony, but it's not just in words, you know, harmony in actual practice. Then you treat each other, and whether it's 6 million Tibetans or a group of people or family, you respect every one of them, and they can all, if they want to be part of the bigger family of the nations, certainly you, at least that in the US here, you know, we have the United States of America, with all the states, and how the states do have the autonomy to kind of determine their own rules, etc., you know, interests. But and then the union is strong. But if we didn't have that, imagine what they went through. So those are things that I think lessons for all our, you know, certainly Beijing is considered, and other countries that are certainly very impressive.
Next question is actually from the audience. It's actually from President Kadir. Does the Uyghur independence movement keep its operation in Turkey? If yes, does your organization in America have any relationship with the ones in Turkey?
In every oppressed people, as I've stated in the past before, there are those who outright fight for their independence, and there are those who really would like to stay, work within the system to get to determine their own future. There are not only Uyghurs in Turkey, but there in Central Asia, there's about 2 million Uyghurs in Central Asia. Those 2 million Uyghurs demand independence. The rest of them are in Turkey, and they all want independence as well. What we believe is in the genuine true dialogue of determining our own future by our own hands. And we have been using this policy for many years, however the results are not as good as we pleased.
For Mr. Cholden. Do Tibet was a great empire before. Why the Tibetan people are satisfied with the social, so-called genuine autonomy instead of independence?
Thank you for the question. The Tibetan people, especially under the leadership of His Holiness the Dalai Lama, who for many years, just so that you know, His Holiness did devolve all of his political authority in 2011. In 2001, most of his authority devolved, so we have elected leadership. But the Dalai Lama has asked the Tibetan people many times. And the Tibetan people, when we had sort of opinion poll, majority of the Tibetans did say that 65% said whatever is the Dalai Lama's advice is for the Tibetan people from time to time. And so the Dalai Lama had always been very firm believer that instead of seeking independence, genuine autonomy that respects all 6 million Tibetans, not just Tibet Autonomous Region, which is about 2 million, all the Tibetans, for them to have genuine autonomy for the preservation of Tibetan culture, language, religion, way of life. That is the most important. And the other reason why that is so important is because, as even what I certainly learned from this good here is that in Tibet we have had for the last many decades a policy of population transfer where many Han Chinese are outnumbering many Tibetans. In Lhasa alone, there's 7-8 times the population of the local Tibetans there. So we are afraid that if this goes unresolved for too long, pretty soon Tibetan identity will be completely eradicated, you know. And certainly, like I said earlier, if I want to be an American citizen, I want to enjoy, but at the same time, as a Tibetan, I'm still going to those that are important for me, values, traditions, religious beliefs, all of those things, I will maintain that. Right? All of us, we are here as immigrants, etc. We do that. But when you're forced under the gun and asked, you have to speak another language, you have to renounce your religion, you have to renounce your religious leader, and you cannot even have freedom of religion, can't even worship, and you can't even have a picture of the Dalai Lama in the home. When you have that kind of repression, then people are certainly very unhappy and it's miserable. So the Dalai Lama, he has right now been trying, but even after he has given up his political leadership, the elected leadership has continued to say that they support, and the Tibetan Parliament has said, we support the Dalai Lama's approach, which is the middle way approach, which is not seeking independence, but also not accepting complete assimilation, forced assimilation. You know, and that is where, you know, if the leadership in Beijing would understand that the Dalai Lama is the best friend right now to solve this, for as long as the Tibetan people are satisfied that it can be resolved. But if it goes unresolved, then certainly it will fester, and unfortunately it will result in a lot of desperate action being taken by younger people who feel hopeless and marginalized. And that would be unfortunate for everyone. So that is why, you know, that's why the Dalai Lama has proposed, and majority of the Tibetan people, even inside Tibet, do support that. And they hope for him to return. And at least hopefully we can even see him as a religious leader there to give teachings and see the Tibetan people. But right now, politically, he has no desire at all. And just so that you know, the Chinese PRC government has always said this is not an issue about the Tibetan people, it's an issue about the Dalai Lama returning to Tibet. And he has said no, he does not care an ounce about whether he goes back and has some kind of position, you know, responsibility, authority. All he cares, is concerned about is the fate of the 6 million Tibetans, and that is what we are striving for.
We have about 20 million
users in the history of time. Autonomy and again, we have been
after they have given us so-called autonomy, but we have lived in tremendous political and
oppression in Israel. As you all know, Mr. Dalai Lama also have openly, publicly stated that, that they need a real, real genuine autonomy. But since then, there has been no progress.
Aslında siyah kılırış, öldürüşünü devamlaştırmadı. Biz halkımız ne? Bizden halkımız hakim ıslaklı olmak için Kıtay komünistlerden kurtulmak için biz hayat kalmayız diye yekek koy.
Simulation and the genocide, the political oppression, it continued to grow up to a point where the ordinary people, Uyghur people, realize right now that is the only way out of this terrible situation is independence.
And Xitay hükümetinin siyasetini biz özümüzden teşkilatımızdan sordunuz. Biz Xitay hükümetinin ki hazırki vaziyetteki kişilik hukuk meselelerini her türlü üçün teşkilatımız yollamadı.
Now you're asking about the human rights situation of Chinese government as related to our own organization in Turkey and in the United States. But what we have been doing is to fight for human rights and dignity of Uyghur people first. And if
the
we have a lot, another problem where with Dalai Lama, while all the Tibetans support Dalai Lama's decision on matters of significant importance such as independence and genuine autonomy, but we have another problem where we have to also convince Uyghur people that middle way is the right way to go, considering the situation.
Since we're running a little bit late, we're going to have one last question answer, and then we'll have a closing speech made by Bangla National President.
So the question is, the democratic movement in Hong Kong, is there the possibility of doing things within the system and without, outside of the system? And the second part is, can we look at Taiwan, the kind of violence, using force instead of being peace and trying to do it within the system. So I'll answer the second part first. Hong Kong democratic movement has taken a lot of inspiration from Taiwan. For example, the umbrella movement, a lot of the slogans or like the tactics are like copied from the Sunflower movement in Taiwan. And also, there are a lot of young people who are coming out to join politics, kind of also taking inspiration from Taiwan. When we see the kind of like the New Power Party or other groups that have really brought up a lot of young politicians. We have taken a lot of hints from Taiwan, and also about using force. Yes, there are groups of people believe in force. That's a new way to push for agendas. And so about a year ago, there was a thing called Free for Revolution. It's somewhat similar to the trigger moment, the February 28th event. Basically, the Hong Kong government does not allow certain street vendors during the Lunar New Year to sell like fish balls on the street. And the people who wants to do that, so they had a conflict with the police, and it really exploded within one night, where it went into a whole kind of riot situation in Hong Kong.
It started as a very, very small thing, just like a street vendor thing, but then it was probably pretty much planned by the Hong Kong government, and they tried to get our internal people all to have conflicts among ourselves. So it started as a really small thing, and then like a street vendor thing, and turns into a pretty violent night fought between citizens and the Hong Kong police. So I think Hong Kong has tried a couple different things. They have tried the peaceful protest with the drug movement, and the last year with the switch ball movement incident. And right now, at least in my opinion, Hong Kong's future, we don't know. We don't know what the correct path is, right? It's going to be peaceful one, or it may require a higher amount of spend, or at least a little bit more of a forceful path. But I think the next couple of years for Hong Kong is very important to learn from the previous lessons and what we can possibly do in the next couple of years. Right now we have a chief executive, which is part of the soil right now. Hopefully, depending on what comes out of that, it may become a little bit better, it may become a little worse, and then Hong Kong pro-democracy movement will take actions because of that.
Thank you very much. I think when we face Chinese government's aggression and suppression, we're on the one family striving for democracy and the human rights for all people. Ladies and gentlemen, can I ask you to give all our speakers another round of applause, please? So, as my wife always reminds me, keep it short and stupid. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming today. Thank you to Mr. Tim Wong, Tony Lee, Tian Wu, and all the team for putting on this event. Thank you very much.